students, having learned the positive aspects of globalization, let us go deeper into it. Okay, now here we have the impact of globalization on environment. Being environmental students, we need to be aware what happens, what all happens for the environment. Is it going to be good or is it going to be bad? Okay, now here we are. The first thing that happens is deforestation. See, as globalization happens, there are more industries coming up, more development happening, and at the same time, this deforestation also happens. Why it happens? The most important industry is the logging industry. Have you seen logs of wood on trucks on the highway being carried from one place to the other, one city to the other, from forest to the places, cities? Yes. What are they used for? Anything that is used for housing and furniture is called timber. So for the sake of timber, there are a lot of trees that are just felled. Okay, they are cut down. The next one is they use it for the pulp, for paper and paper products. Okay, so these are the two things for which this logging industry happens. And it is just everywhere and anywhere. Okay, so that results in merciless cutting down of trees. Next one is the ranch. See, when you need meat and meat products, we need a lot of cattle. And where do we breed those cattle? Only when there is enough grass, the cattle will grow and will multiply. So for that, we need large farms. They are called ranches. And these, especially in North America and in Australia, they cut down the forests. Okay, they completely, the trees are cut down and grass is grown so that they can have these ranches. Okay, then next is the soybean cultivation. We speak about renewable resources, and we speak about alternate fuels, hybrid fuels, and here is one which forms biodiesel. And we get it from soybean. And this soybean, again, where is it coming from? It, all the forests have to be cut down. Okay, so these are the three reasons why this deforestation happens. Of course, besides this, you have these developmental projects like rail projects are there, road projects are there, then they cut down the trees. There, that is housing, shelter, everything. All right, next, when the forests are gone, biodiversity is gone. We lose precious animals and birds and plants because of deforestation. The next one is overfishing. Everywhere it is touched upon. See, if the forests are gone, the meat and the cattle, everything is being touched upon. Everything needs the demand is high and a rise is there. So no, this is no exception. There is a demand for more fishes also. Sometimes you can see areas of land that are just, cornered, and in that the fish are the breeding grounds for that. Okay, they develop the fish and then they grow it, multiply it, and then it is being sold. But sometimes the amount that is sold, the demand is more than the multiplication process. So we don't give enough time for the fish, and because of that, some of the species become extinct. Extinct means they are completely wiped out from the earth. It is sad, isn't it? Yeah. Next one is our pollution. Actually, these three points, we can put it under this natural resources, because we are losing out on our forest, we are losing out on our plants and animals and birds, and we are losing out on aquatic organisms. So that's the impact that it gives on the environment. Also, this is indirectly connected to the environment because it is resulting in pollution. So though then it doesn't have anything to do with the natural resources, but because the natural resources are all going away or cut down or coming down, this results in pollution. How do you get this pollution? See, from one country to the other, different countries have different standards. For example, you take the European norms that we learned about in the caring for our air. What do we do? There is a vehicle emission test that is happening in the European countries. They have a particular norm. Percentage of carbon monoxide should not exceed this. Hydrocarbon should not exceed this. So those are the norms set by the European countries. We have in India, we have Bharat norms. Like that, different countries have different norms. But the percentage that is permissible is different. So some countries don't insist. See, in our country, if we don't have the emission certificate done once in 6 months, we are fined. So we automatically, it sets in our mind and we are able to do it. But there are countries where they don't bother about it. So such relaxation in some countries make it cool and the pollution becomes more. So that's one thing. Then there is increased competition. See, when there is an increase in competition in marketing, in industries, okay, so again, when you come to different standards, if there is one country that doesn't even insist on the pollution certificate for the industry or the distance that it is from the city, nothing is bothered about, then what happens? There is no waste treatment. So they will easily have a big unit and all the liquid waste effluents will be just washed into the water bodies, maybe a sea or a river, all the aquatic organisms are killed or affected. Then there is no pollution control measures. Okay, so they don't actually need to control because there's nobody to check, so they don't control at all. Okay, so these are the impacts that we have on the environment and the natural resources. Now we move on to the impact of globalization on developing countries. What are developing countries and developed countries? There's a vast difference between developed countries and developing countries. The gap is always more. You know, they are economically, they are less privileged. Okay, they are not so developed. Okay, they are underdeveloped. Okay, so what is the effect of globalization because of this? See, sometimes some parts are so remote that they were out of touch or nobody knew about them. They were so isolated. But here is this globalization that has brought them together. The first thing, we can divide it into three phases, how it has developed or how it has impacted the developing countries. First one is the economy and the trade. Okay, generally, when these developed countries come and invest on the developing countries, the economy of the country, of the people, slowly increases. It improves because they get some source of income. Okay, that's the first thing. Then trade. Okay, even the smaller products, the larger ones, they are able to manufacture so many things, and then that is being marketed, and then totally the economy improves. Then because of that, the poverty is also reduced. So there were some families where they were striving to even make ends meet, like they didn't have food to eat and they used to go and beg. Now, if one of them is educated, then they get a job and then the whole family, the status and the lifestyle changes. Okay, so poverty is reduced to a great extent. Economy grows. See, sometimes when they want to develop on themselves, they get loans. The developing countries get loans from International Monetary Fund or World Bank, and then they develop themselves. Then the developed countries invest in the developing countries. Why? Because they have the raw material. Okay, this is very, very important. The raw material is provided by the developing countries. For example, if you take Africa, in some remote areas of Africa, you have what is the mines. Okay, there are a lot of minerals and they are rich in so many minerals that can be taken. And so that becomes the raw material for so many chemical industries. You understand? So that is how these developing countries, they also go hand in hand. Okay, so these people provide the raw material, those people provide the method, and then overall everything is given an uplift. Next is education and health. See, if they are investing on bigger units and industries, naturally there are better jobs that are available. Now, no one is going to come from a developed country to work in a developing country. So the people in the developing country have to match that standard. How do they match? They have to be having better skills. How will they get the better skills? Only if they have higher education, then they can match to that standard. So now automatically their education is improving. Okay, it has improved. And so then you have improved healthcare. See, in earlier days, it would take a long time to diagnose some of the ailments. But today, it's just, you know, a fraction of seconds and minutes. You have some scanning done and images are seen and then it is learned. And then you just exactly drive on to the point. Okay, so we can do the healthcare in such precise manner. Also, the medicines that are being invented day after day is becoming so specific and so very effective. For example, if you take medicines for cancer, earlier days, you know, it was not so effective. But as the days go by, they say, now there is a recent drug. There's a recent drug discovered in this country that we could bring it here and it could be helping them. It can increase the lifespan. It can kill the cells effectively. So that much of healthcare is improved because of this globalization on developing countries. Next, we go to the culture. Okay, so we imitate the culture of the developed countries. So things that they were not exposed to, all these are available and they are accessible through electronic gadgets like TV is there. Then you have internet facility, connectivity is there. Even in parts, nook and corner of the any area, it may be a hilly area or a forest, still they have some connectivity or the other through which they are able to access and they are able to learn the cultural differences and they are able to imitate the cultures. So these are the three factors which these are the impact that you have on the developing countries. So with this, we finish this video. More to you again in the next video. So stay tuned. If you like it, you can like, share, and don't forget to subscribe to this channel. Bye-bye.